Welcome to the AFN Sports Arena with Jantzee and Tory. I'm Jantzee Ellis, here with the Air Force Staff Sergeant Tory Cusimano. Oh, you got a crying baby today?
That is not the reaction that I was expecting today. I must have made somebody angry or sad.
Well, you can make it up to him by having a great show, I guess. Well, it's a beautiful day here in Okinawa, Japan, and today we're coming to you with some great news. AFN has officially obtained the rights to air the highly anticipated Floyd Mayweather-Conor McGregor fight.
That's what I'm talking about. Where was that earlier?
They're excited about this fight. So this means that on Sunday, August 27th at 10 a.m. Japan time, you can catch the full fight card in the comfort of your living room on AFN Sports. That's right. What will normally cost a pay-per-view customer $99, you can watch for free.
For free?
Yes.
Zero doll hairs?
Zero doll hairs.
Zero bones? No yennies will be spent on this
yennies or Benjamins.
That's excellent. That's one of the nice things about AFN, man. We got those boxing events, those UFC pay-per-views. Even if you're into WWE, we get those pay-per-views a lot of the time for free. So make sure you enjoy it.
Exactly. There are a lot of benefits. And there will be a viewing party put on by Tory MWR over at Havana's on Tory Station, and stay tuned on Facebook for all the latest info on the viewing parties near you as the fight gets closer.
And these are things that are, like, it would behoove you to watch them in a group of people because of the hype reactions that are sure to occur.
Exactly. The smack talking's half the fun, right?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, now let's break down this bout. Why is everyone so enticed by the thought of the greatest boxer of his generation and an MMA fighter with zero professional boxing experience fighting each other?
I mean, I think you just said it. That's pretty intriguing.
But doesn't that seem pretty lopsided?
I mean, yeah, but remember, what was that Rocky movie that came out where he came out of retirement to fight some young boxer?
Because I think that was Rocky Five.
Yeah, it was Rocky Five.
Rocky Five.
Yeah. But that's what you see is the media, especially in a 24-hour news cycle now that ESPN does, just like regular news coverage with sports coverage, a lot of times there's not a lot of news to cover, so they start just coming up with these what-ifs, and they came up with what if the biggest star in UFC, Conor McGregor, stepped into the ring and fought Floyd Mayweather, who presumably is the biggest star in boxing right now, or one of the best talents of his generation. And so many people are so intrigued by that, and both of those guys who are very ambitious and very money-driven.
And have very loud mouths and very big pride.
How could they pass
issues?
That up? I mean, if you're Conor McGregor, what have you got to lose? You have a huge payday coming your way, much bigger than you're getting in the UFC. And for Floyd Mayweather, you're thinking, I could beat this dude blind.
Exactly.
I could beat him with my left hand.
But who do you think has more to lose? I personally think it's Floyd Mayweather because he has that perfect 49-0 record.
Right.
And coming out of retirement and putting a blemish on that, that's pretty risky, don't you think?
Definitely risky for him. He's got his entire reputation to lose, losing to a guy who's not even a trained boxer.
Yeah.
For Conor McGregor.
He had his roots in boxing back in Ireland. That's where he started. But he's nowhere on the level.
Right, exactly. And for Conor McGregor, even if he loses, if he just puts up a good fight, it's a moral victory for him.
Yeah.
Because if he loses, all his fan base is going to say is, oh, you know, he's not a boxer.
Mm-hmm.
What did you expect?
Yeah. He doesn't have too much to lose, but a whole lot to gain.
Yes.
Now, there was a great article by ESPN combat sports writers Dan Raphael and Brett Akimoto comparing the fighters. And I took away a few things from that. But what I think is the most impressive is that McGregor, in all of his fights that he's won, 85% have been knockouts. Whereas in Mayweather's 49 victories, only 26 have been knockouts, and he hasn't knocked somebody out since 2011.
Yeah, Mayweather's game is a defensive one.
Exactly.
He's one of the best defensive boxers you'll ever see. The dude can dodge a bullet, it seems like, sometimes.
His reflexes are insane.
Yeah, and with that type of defensive boxing comes like a counterpunch type of approach where he's waiting for you to make a mistake and then jump in there and capitalize on it. So McGregor's really going to have to stay within himself in this one.
He is. And McGregor, like we said, he lives and dies by the knockout. His two UFC titles have been won by knockout. I mean, it's been rumored in training that in training for this fight, McGregor's knocked out two of his sparring partners already.
Well, we saw the YouTube clip of the guy falling down, and there's been a lot of controversy about whether he was actually knocked down or whether he was pushed down. Listen, I'm like blindly hoping that McGregor just comes out and is it's this great.
Rooting for the underdog.
Yeah, I want to root for him because he is the underdog. And also, I hate Mayweather. But even if I didn't hate Mayweather, I would still be rooting for McGregor in this one because you're right. He is the underdog.
Yeah. And like I said, the only place that McGregor has the advantage is in pure power. But even with that, I mean, in all of Mayweather's 49 fights, he's only been knocked down once.
I mean, there you
go. He's resilient.
That's the defensive strength that he shows. So this really is a strength-on-strength battle because McGregor wants to come at you. He wants to go heavy on the offense. And Mayweather, that plays right into his hands. So we'll see.
It is. And because he's not a big knockout guy, Mayweather goes the distance. 12 rounds. Easy. That's what he does. Whereas McGregor, his only hope is to get it done in the first few rounds.
We shall see. Now that they've, well, I know we're going to talk about this later, but now that they moved down to the 8-ounce gloves.
Yes.
McGregor has said now 2 rounds is all it will
take.
Yes,
his original prediction was 4 rounds.
Right, now but they dropped two. From the 10-ounce gloves to the 8-ounce.
So like you said, it was just announced that the Nevada Athletics Commission granted the request of both fighters to use the 8-ounce gloves instead of the mandated 10-ounce gloves for this 154-pound weight class. Now, why that is important is that the lighter the glove, the more power the fighter feels. So in MMA, they usually use 4-ounce gloves, and Mayweather usually fights at a lower weight class than this 154-pound weight class, and he uses 8-ounce gloves regularly. But it was said that Mayweather specifically wanted this higher weight class to fight with the 10-ounce gloves. So it was kind of a surprise when Mayweather came out on Instagram and said, "Let's fight with 8-ounce gloves."
Maybe he found somewhere along his training that he wasn't hacking it with the 10-ounce because it does make a big difference.
Or he succumbed to all of during their world tour.
Right.
That was a big, you know, jab point from McGregor that he was saying, you know, we can fight whatever with whatever gloves you want. You can give me the biggest gloves, whatever, blah, blah, blah. I'll still knock you out. So I think he kind of gave in to the smack talk and the hype a little bit, or he's just really confident. And if we know anything about Mayweather, it's that he is an over-prepared fighter, almost neurotic.
Yeah, no,
he
definitely
knows his opponent. So I don't see it as too big of a surprise.
No, and I was
partially
reading up on it.
A publicity stunt, I think.
Yeah, well, and the boxing commission that sets those standards as far as the glove weight at certain weight classes. They a group sort of recommended to them, they hired a group to do that, and it wasn't based on any sort of science. And the group that came to them and said, hey,
just
here's what we recommend,
kind
but
of.
Like, you need to do a study on this. And they're planning on doing it. So the change from 10-ounce to 8-ounce gloves isn't really, like, for me, it's a non-issue. It's just comfort level for both fighters, and I think it'll make for a better fight overall.
I think it will too. I'm really excited for this. And with that said, Mayweather is the heavy favorite, but the gap has been closing as the fight draws closer. Mayweather's odds have declined while McGregor's have improved.
Ooh.
Yeah. Currently, Mayweather is the 2-9 favorite, with McGregor sporting 13-4 odds.
What in the world could have changed that, I wonder, because they had the public workout. So, I mean, it's not like McGregor was, like, looking like
smack talk
Drogo out there to bring him up again.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Maybe it's got to be the smack talk earning him brownie points on the odds.
And to put those odds in perspective, Mayweather opened as a 2-45 favorite, while McGregor was a 19-2 underdog. That's according to Odds Shark. So there has been a big jump, and it's actually kind of surprising. But I think just how confident McGregor has been, people are jumping on board with that, and people love an underdog story.
Yeah,
as
it's infectious, to be sure.
Yes.
I admit I have been wooed by his confidence.
His confidence and profanity, and we will see. Make sure you tune in, and it's the full fight card. And the prelims start at 8 a.m. On Sunday, August 27th, with the actual card starting at 10 a.m. And, you know, the headliner with McGregor and Mayweather won't be until a little later. But it will be a great day of combat sports spectacle.
I'm very exciting, or very excited, I should say.
Now, speaking of surprising betting odds and Las Vegas, the Oakland, soon-to-be Las Vegas Raiders, are receiving a ton of love at the betting window and are receiving more bets than any other team to win the Super Bowl.
Really?
That surprised me
more
when
than
I read
the
that.
New England Patriots.
Yes, actually. The
who
Raiders
won the Super Bowl and added pieces to their roster.
I know. The Raiders' Super Bowl odds opened up all the way at 20-1, but have moved to as short as 6-1 now that we're getting closer to the season. And the only team with better odds than the Raiders right now are the Patriots, your defending champs at 3-1.
Okay, so the Raiders have jumped up.
Well, they're still the favorites, but they aren't receiving as many bets. The Raiders are receiving more bets than the Patriots. The Patriots just have better odds.
That's insane to me. The Raiders have proven nothing.
I know.
Derek Carr had one good year.
Okay, that's what I was going to ask you. Do you think it's just because all the people in Vegas, they're seeing the billboards, they're getting excited, they're seeing that the Raiders are coming in 2019?
That could very well be it.
Or is there something to back it up? I mean, like you said, they had a pretty good season. They went 12-4, and had Derek Carr not broken his fibula in week 16, they could have challenged the Patriots. It could have been a possibility.
Mm-hmm.
But they also have the addition of Marshawn Lynch, who came out of retirement.
Yeah.
I know you had your doubts on if he'll still
We'll see what he has left in the tank. The shelf life for an NFL running back is not very long.
Mm-mm.
And especially with the style of play that he employs,
mm-hmm.
it's very hard on your body. I wish him the best, mm-hmm. even though he plays for the Raiders, and I hate the Raiders. I question how dominant he can really be.
Yeah, we'll see. Well, Jack Del Rio has big plans, and people are getting on board. But it's not just for the Super Bowl that there are more bets for the Raiders. They have more bets for winning the AFC West than there are for any other team to win any division.
Well, you look around
That's
the AFC West.
Me.
I mean, their biggest challenge, I think, is going to be Kansas City. Mm-hmm. Kansas City has – there's a lot of parity. After the Broncos won the Super Bowl a couple years ago, both the Chiefs and the Raiders kind of jumped on board with constructing their rosters
mm-hmm.
that same way, with dominant defense and an offense that has some firepower but that isn't going to lose you
mm-hmm.
games. And it's come along a little bit quicker for the Raiders, I think. But Kansas City is a good squad.
They are.
And Denver's defense is still dominant. And if they can figure it out on offense, then they'll provide a challenge
situation.
Too. But I have to agree with the bettors here. I think the clear pick for the AFC West division champ this year mm-hmm. is the Raiders.
And Derek Carr, like you said, he's back. He's feeling good. And they've made some good acquisitions to the offensive line. And, you know, like Leanne Toohey says, after you pay the mortgage, the first check is to the insurance. So I think you're right. As much as it pains me, I think they will have a really great season. Winning the Super Bowl, I mean, you already predicted the Browns. So, I mean, you can't make another prediction,
that's
right?
That's right. I can't go back on that prediction.
You ride that one out.
I'm dancing with the one that brung me on that. We'll see. No, I'm a certified Raider hater.
Uh-huh.
They're all card-carrying members of my punk list.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that they're going to take the division this year.
Yeah. Well, we'll see how dominating they're actually capable of being. And we can't end the show without talking about how dominating Giancarlo Stanton has been. At the home plate for the Marlins recently, please tell me you've seen some of the balls he's been cracking out there.
He has always been known for crushing home mm-hmm. runs, and when he hits them far. He
mm-hmm.
doesn't get a lot of cheap ones.
Mm-mm.
But the streak of dominance that he has shown over the last 6, 7, 8 games and even back to a couple months has been incredible. He's on pace right now to hit, 61 home
yes.
runs?
Yes.
He hit 6 in a row, or he hit a home run in 6 games in a row.
I mean, he currently has 44 homers on the season, and like we said, he just barely came up short the 8-game record for consecutive games with a home run, and he didn't quite get that, but that doesn't change that his pace is incredible. According to the Elias Sports Bureau, Stanton is the first player with 19 home runs in a 31-game span since Braves catcher Javi Lopez did in 2003.
My goodness.
There's been a lot of sluggers since then.
Yeah, and a lot of really good hitters out there.
Yeah. But, I mean, he's that 6'6", 245-pound monster.
Yeah,
he was Aaron Judge before there was Aaron Judge.
That's absolutely right. And it's crazy to me, too, because the Miami Marlins are not a good baseball
mm-mm.
team. So why is anybody pitching to Giancarlo Stanton, the artist formerly known as Mike?
That's right. And we just need to keep watching him. And he's finally healthy. He's had a lot of health issues over the past few seasons.
Mm-hmm.
When he was younger, you know, he had a couple of rookie records and people were thinking, whoa, the sky's the limit for him. And he got that humongous deal, $325 million or something like that. He deserved it, but he hadn't lived up to it. But boy, he is now. And the biggest record that any slugger is chasing is that single-season home run record. And Giancarlo says he's shooting for the number 61. Now, the previous record set in 1961 before Barry Bonds shattered it with the current record of 73 in 2001. But we know that that record has a huge asterisk next to it because that was during the steroid era.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Stanton kind of hinted to that when he said he's shooting for 61.
Yeah, I think you have to take those steroid guys, Barry Bonds, Mark McGwire, mm-hmm. Sammy Sosa, put them in a completely different mm-hmm. category, a different list entirely. Mm-hmm. So 61 home runs makes him the best home run hitter in today's MLB.
Yes, yes. And he says he's only shooting for 61, but he's on pace to beat Barry Bonds' record of 73. So we shall see. And you can catch Stanton and the Marlins in action tomorrow, Friday, August 11th, as they take on the Washington Nationals at 10 p.m. on AFN Sports. We've got a lot of great baseball coming up. Well, that's going to have to do it for us this week. Make sure you hit subscribe and join us next week, as we'll be joined by Dave Orenauer of Stars and Stripes.
Really, guys, for Dave?
He is the local sports hero around here.
Yeah, he is.
Been around for a long time. He is a cache of invaluable knowledge. He's great. So make sure you tune in. We'll get the lowdown on local football kicking off next week and everything you need to know about Dodea Sports. Thanks for joining us in the AFN Sports Arena. I'm Jantzee Ellis, and he's
Air Force Staff Sergeant Tory Cusimano.
Have a great weekend. And don't forget, you have to look good to play good.